So welcome to today's class. The session is about data science. Using R, Python as well, we will be discussing about Minitab and Excel Miner as well. These are the additional two tools that you will be getting hands on. R and Python are open source, whereas Minitab and Excel Miner are licensed versions. So going forward, you might want to purchase it, or if you are joining a company where they have these licensed versions, you should not say that you don't know, right? So at least you can have some basic hands-on, then you'll be able to say that, yes, I have some knowledge on the tool and I'll be exploring it so that, right, you can get an opportunity in a company. So we represent XLR and InnoDataTex. Both are our companies. XLR is predominantly into trainings. We deal with corporate trainings, school or university education, individual education, and we do not go with the regular classes, I mean the regular technical courses. We deal with all the high-end courses like data science, IoT, then you have blockchain, right? So all the advanced techniques basically. And InnoDataTex is a company where we deal with consulting projects. So we promise that all the participants which are associated with us, they will be getting a hands-on experience on real-time projects. That is because of InnoDataTex. So we have multiple projects. Currently we are running around 15 projects parallel. And on those projects, on real-time, students like you are working. Provided you complete the tasks that we give as part of the regular sessions. So there will be assignments that are given to you. You have to complete them, submit them. We vet these things. We see what are the things that you are good at, what are the things that you are need to work on. And based on the feedback, you are going to prepare accordingly, and parallelly you are going to work on the projects. So these are the slide which gives the gist of the things that we are going to learn, tools wise. And you will be given a basic idea about Hadoop and Spark as well. Okay, Hadoop anyways, you are getting e-learning videos, around 40 hours of e-learning videos will be given to you, wherein you will have Hadoop and SAS both. Now SAS we are not talking, but if I have to say data science, then a lot of people, the old timers, they will be speaking about SAS, because that was the tool which ruled these statisticians. They used to go with this. But the problem with SAS is it is licensed version and it is very, very costly. And there are around 200 components within SAS, and if you have to work on a specific module, you have to purchase that particular component. So given an opportunity, if I'll say that there are two things, one is for free, one is for price, which one we go for? Obviously free thing, right? So that's where R has taken over SAS. Because R is just an open source, you're going to download it. It's going to be less than 100 MB. Download it, start working on it. And trust me, if you can spend at least 4 hours on daily basis, then 1 week time you can master R. It's that simple. And that's the reason people have migrated from SAS to R, especially statisticians. Because if I ask a statistician to sit down and write a code, he will not be able to do it. He doesn't have the capability, right? Though he is very good with statistics, he is not good with computer. So R is going to bridge that gap between statistician and the computer. You will see, eventually you will learn how easy this R is. But now, thanks to IT folks, a lot of developers, they are exploring this GitHub capabilities of writing codes. They are good with C, they are good with Java, etc., which are really complicated courses, right, or tools, I should say. I don't know how I passed. But yeah, yes, Srikant, we are going to deal with R and Python, both. I'm explaining that. So these people, when they came into adventure into data science, they took Python as the best tool for writing programs. There are limitations within R. like it's a memory based software, it is a single threaded software, and thanks to big data that we have right now, R fails in a lot of things. It crashes down because it requires a lot of RAM. Whereas Python is a little bit capable of handling big data, but complicated when I say writing codes. But there are inbuilt packages that we are going to use both in R and Python thanks to the open source. A lot of people are doing research and they have already provided a lot of code for us. So we're just going to call the packages. Packages are nothing but predefined functions. So we're going to call them and use them for interpreting the data. So first we'll learn R, we'll start with R, and slowly we will also learn Python by comparing the code with R. This way, people who are not from programming background, for them it will be very easy to learn Python as well. And as I told, Excel Miner is a tool which is licensed. It sits on top of MS Office, MS Excel Pages. It's a plugin. You will get a 15-day trial version for Excel Miner, and after that you can use Cloud World. Minitab is another very famous tool. It is also a licensed version. You will be getting a 30-day trial version of Minitab. So what all the assignments that we share, the practice that you have to do, has to be completed in these respective dates, 30 days and 15 days. So forecasting is something that we are going to deal with in the end of the sessions, because that's where you'll get Excel Miner into picture. So you want to keep things in the last so that you'll concentrate only on that topic for 15 days. Minitab, it's very easy. Again, it is navigation based. Click on menu items and job done. We are learning these tools because they are still industry favorites. Around 85% or 90% of the companies are still using Minitab for basic statistics, and for time series analysis, Excel Miner is preferred. So we are going to learn these two. And the last one here you are seeing is Tableau. So you guys are already aware, it's a BI tool. Analytical capabilities are there in that. And it is the market leader. Tableau is the market leader in analytical and BI space. So if you want to present reports, days are gone where you are going to create MS Office or your PowerPoint presentations. These are done. Now we have live dashboards coming to picture where you might want to bring in analytics as well. So that's where Tableau fits in. A data scientist should have multiple capabilities. One is basic statistics. When I say basic statistics, 8 class, 9 class, 10 class maths is required, which we already know. We have completed this education long time back. So we're going to refresh that. Post that, the person has to have good communication skills, good logical thinking. You should not be technical. I mean, technicality is not required. There is some other person who's going to sit down and code. For data scientists, you need to have logical thinking. Management skills should be there. How to deliver a business project, how to run a project into profits. These are the things that you have to think of. Okay, that's where your strategies are actually built. Next is, you should be a very good storyteller. Okay, so married people, they know guys are very good storytellers. Okay, so you should be very good storytellers, because when you are presenting your reports, the client should agree on what you are saying. He needs to get convinced. Okay, so you can search on Google, you'll say data scientists are storytellers. Okay, all right. All this storytelling is done using live dashboards that are created in Tableau. It is a niche role. Companies like Deloitte, CA, all the basic MNCs, big MNCs, they have specific role for Tableau developers, Tableau administrators. So people who are in a senior role, I think some people. Harish, are you not able to view the screen? People who are having issues with video or my screen, can you please ping? Is my screen visible to everyone? Now let me quickly go through the demo session. I'll introduce you guys what exactly we are going to learn, what exactly is data and all that. So to begin with, we will look into big data. Now what is big data? Only huge amount of data. Okay. And so there is no basic definition for big data. In simple words, it says the data which is too big in terms of volume, in terms of velocity, and in terms of variety. So these are the three V's which define big data. Now, are these only three V's? No. There are around 30 or 40 odd V's that are defined online. But these are the three V's which define big data. There is something called as veracity, which is being talked about now, which tells us what is the quality of the data. There is huge data generated, but out of which, what is the quality of the data? How much data can we use? There will be a lot of junk data also getting generated. So that is defined by veracity. Now, if you see, all these are where data is getting generated from various parts. So these are few examples. Only few examples. Right? So even including us, we generate huge data every day, day in, day out. So now I'm generating data. I'm recording this video, right? The session. So that is nothing but a data. So the good thing is, thanks to technology, thanks to the smart devices, right? We are able to load this data, record this data and store it so that in future we can do some kind of analysis. Data is called as the new oil. Okay, you know the importance of oil. A lot of countries are almost at the stake of war for this, right? So data is treated as new oil. And yeah, this Mars rover that is also generating data, right? Which is sitting somewhere on Mars. You know, how does this Mars rover all alone handle things in Mars? There is no human to control it. It is venturing onto the surface of the Mars and sending the details. I'll explain in a very simple way so that you'll understand what is machine learning, because that is something that we are going to learn. So if you see this Mars rover, which is all alone in Mars, nobody is controlling it, but it is on its own, right, venturing on the surface and gathering the data and sending it. It's a machine, right? So if there is a stone in front of it, what does it have? It is not a living thing, right? But it is interpreting these things, and if there is a stone, takes back few steps, diverts the path and goes into a new path, right? So how does it do it? What do you think? Okay, image processing. Okay, that's okay, everybody is saying image processing, so you guys are aware of something. Okay, good. Image processing is done, fine, but in that image it will know that it is a stone or some object. After that, what? It has to take an action, right? So you are going to train the conditions. That's machine learning. We take data, okay, we create, right? We create this kind of environment for Mars rover, and we collect the data when it is going into a store. So it records the data, and in that data we provide solutions, saying that if this is the situation, do this action. Like that, we are creating numerous number of conditions or situations, and we give this data to the machine. And whenever it arises and whenever it has to handle a situation, it looks into the data. And based on the solution, it acts. So in simple terms, this is machine learning. More and more situations we feed in, better the learning, better the actions, right? Just like our humans, I mean, if you talk about a small kid, he is not aware of so many things. Eventually, he will learn by his experiences, right? So the same thing for machine learning. Machine learning, human learning. Now, all these are various areas where data is getting generated. Smart devices, everybody is almost wearing them nowadays.